This is the Almost Timely newsletter for the week of February 4th, 2024. Content authenticity statement: 100% of this week's newsletter is generated by me, the human. When I do use AI, I will disclose it prominently. There's a link at the top of the newsletter you can click on to learn why this kind of disclosure is now legally required for anyone doing business in any capacity with the EU. The EU ratified the EU AI Act this week, and one of the key provisions is you must disclose the use of AI. If you do business with the EU at all, which even means people from the EU are visiting your corporate website, the EU AI Act applies to you. It's just like GDPR. If you had to be compliant for GDPR, you got to be compliant for the EU AI Act. All right, what's on my mind this week? Let's talk about what AI has made scarce. Let's talk about generative AI obliquely. A lot of conversations occurred this week about the future of AI, from congressional testimonials of, you know, big tech companies. Ugh, that was a mess. Talk about the blind leading the blind. To the ratification of the EU AI Act, which is now the gold standard for regulating AI planet-wide. All this stuff is important, but let's take a step back to look at the big picture. AI, generative AI in particular, is really good at creating stuff. And boy, can it create stuff at scale. We've talked in the past, and I cover extensively in our Generative AI for Marketers course, the six broad categories for generative AI, the six use case categories: generation, extraction, summarization, rewriting, classification, and question answering. Today's tools are very capable of creating stuff in all these six categories. The net effect thus far has been the creation of a lot of stuff, right? You can't scroll past a page or two on the social network of your choice without seeing AI-generated art, AI-generated text, AI-generated comments, even if those comments sound really robotic. You can't escape it. You can't escape news headlines about the use of AI in election tampering or reducing headcount and layoffs, as we've been seeing the last couple of weeks. So that brings us to the subject of today. In a world where some things, like content, are abundant, what isn't? What is scarce? What is rare and therefore valuable? Think about it. We value things that are scarce, right? Gold wouldn't be valuable if you could find it all over the place, but because it's scarce and useful, but scarce, it has value. Answering this question about scarcity is the key to unlocking economic opportunity, to defending your employment, to building your brand. For good or ill, generative AI levels the playing field considerably. One of the, well, frankly, shocking findings in the Harvard Business School case study on generative AI last year was that it transformed low-performing consultants into high-performing consultants in just a few hours, a five-hour study. Right? That means everyone has the ability for tasks that generative AI does well to be at least slightly above average, right? There's no more low performer. Now everyone is at least slightly above average if they use generative AI well. We know content is abundant, perhaps overabundant. Information in general is abundant. Speed is abundant for many things. The ability to get something has never been faster or easier in human history. Just open up this device and things can appear, right? Hell, last year, I managed to get a package from Amazon delivered into an active war zone in less than 6 weeks, right? Which is absolutely nuts when you think about getting anything into a war zone ever, right? Amazon can deliver in the middle of an armed conflict. Ideas, potential and actualized, are abundant and will be ever more abundant as generative AI gets better. People use it for brainstorming. People use it for creating first drafts of things. Now, today, some generative AI tasks, like music composition, are really pretty lame. They're pretty crappy still. That is not going to be the case going forwards. Right? Generative AI will be able to do that, and then that will be abundant too. So, what is not abundant? Information is abundant, but correct information is not. Now more than ever, we have our choice of information in varying degrees of correctness, from outright lies to peer-reviewed truths in credible journals, right? Our machines can create stories and information, but they aren't inherently truthful. Generative AI is not inherently truthful. In fact, it is inherently hallucinatory by design. Take any mildly controversial topic, like whether the planet is round or not, right? And you will find abundant incorrect information. The planet is round. It's not flat. Truthfulness, factual correctness, this is comparatively scarce. And when you get to a lightning rod topic like vaccines, for example, you will find so much false information in much greater abundance than truthful information. I mean, after all, think about it. Like, lying about the safety of a vaccine requires no peer review process, so you can say whatever you want. That's false. The truth actually requires, you know, investigation. By the way, for the record, any vaccine authorized by both the USA, Food and Drug Administration, and the EU, European Medicines Agency, is safe and effective. It would not pass both sets of regulatory authorities and still be unsafe. This even extends to things like software. Generative AI can crank out code. It can write code. It can write code really well, and a lot of it. But is it correct code? A lot of the time, when generative AI used to code, it cranks out code that's like 98% correct. But 98% correct software doesn't run. 100% correct software runs. So while development of software is abundant, QA is scarce. Useful information is also scarce. There is no shortage of information, but there's a shortage of useful, compact information. Go look at the length of some of those popular podcasts and shows right now. They're like jaw-droppingly long, like 2 hour, 3 hour, 4 hour episodes. Like, do you really need 4 hours to correctly communicate the useful parts? Probably not. I mean, go on to YouTube Shorts and you can see the cogent parts in 60 seconds. Well-understood information is scarce. Take generative AI. There is no shortage of content about things like prompt engineering, but much of it is templated stuff and hacks made by snake oil salesmen, right? The usual crowd moving from trend to trend. These are the same people hawking NFTs 2 years ago as the next big thing, and suddenly they're AI experts now. They're ChatGPT gurus. Take my ChatGPT prompt engineering for ultimate mastery course. Okay. Well-understood information. Those folks don't have a good understanding of the technology itself. Compare that with folks like Dr. Fei-Fei Li, who has been working in AI and publishing peer-reviewed papers on the topic since 2008. You know, I'll talk about somebody who understands what's going on inside a model. Dr. Li would be a good example. Well-understood, well-researched information is scarce. Time is scarce. In fact, made even more scarce by the abundance of information. It feels like we have less time than ever as we have more places to be, more work to do, more obligations to carry. Parkinson's law says that work expands to fill the time allotted for its completion. And the inverse is true. With generative AI, we can do more work faster, so we get more work to do. Right? It's never, hey, I got all my work done in an hour. I'm going to take the next 7 hours off. And companies like be like, cool, that's fine. See you tomorrow. No, that doesn't happen. Right now, money is scarce at a societal level and at a personal level for many people. Big picture, our civilization, and this is not just one country, this is many countries on the planet. Our civilization as a whole just ran the printing presses and printed money like crazy in 2020, the first year of the pandemic. That is a major driver of inflation. When you just print money, the value of money goes down, inflation goes up. Since then, governments have been slowly trying to claw back that excess money that they created, taking it out of circulation. And as a result, money, mainly in the form of lending and borrowing and investing, has become scarce. You see all these big tech layoffs and you know, VC funds drying up. It's because the cheap, easy money has gone away. So you get layoffs, you get downsizing, because no one can borrow 0% money indefinitely anymore. Combine that with record corporate profits after taxes, which means we're all paying more, thanks to price increases above and beyond inflation, and money is scarce for the individual person around the planet. For example, I ran an analysis recently. Across the board, for the like 80% of countries, the price of a Big Mac has increased since 2019, on average about 20%, right? In the USA, where I am, it's 24%. In Argentina, it's well over 100%. The price has more than doubled since 2019 for the Big Mac, right? So money is scarce because we're just paying more for everything. And again, that's planet-wide. That's not just one country. Actual connection to other human beings is alarmingly scarce, right? You and me, us having this conversation is scarce. You can't go a day without another bit of news talking about, you know, the loneliness crisis, and that is a real thing. The hyperpolarization of our information climate makes adversaries of everyone about everything, no matter what you believe in, right? No matter what side you're on, there's something that you've been told to vehemently, maybe even violently disagree with someone else about. And as a result, our circles of friends and people we trust and like dwindle because of this hyper-reactionary environment where we just cut off more and more people we disagree with because we're told to by our information environment. And the people we have left, we're kind of relegated to talking about things like the weather and other safe topics instead of having meaningful conversations about controversial topics because we have been conditioned by our media environment to just outright reject certain points of view. So connection to other people, that's scarce. Trust is scarce because of competing interests and the alarmist media environment where everything has to be amped up to 11 just to earn a few clicks and sell some ads. People don't trust anything nearly as much as they used to. If you look at the 2024 Edelman Trust Barometer, we don't trust anything, right? The highest level of category that people have trust in is businesses. That's going to go well. And 59% of people trusted businesses, which means there's a whole 41% of people like, we don't trust anything. That is almost a majority. That is almost a majority of people who just don't trust anything. So what do we take away for this big picture look at what's scarce versus what's abundant? What do we do with this information? In whatever business or industry you're in, how much of what you do is abundant? Ask yourself that. How much of what you do is scarce? If your content marketing program is, let's make more stuff, that you're making stuff that's already abundant. It's not going to differentiate you. It's not going to provide you opportunity. Many industries are in this trap. They're running into trouble because they fail to recognize these shifts in abundance and scarcity. Take newspapers. Newspapers struggle in part because their revenue models were undermined by the internet, right? Nobody buys classifieds anymore. But also because newspapers failed to recognize they are not the source of information anymore, right? The internet is. They could be a source of credible information that's well-vetted and well-researched, but many of them have had a lot of trouble making that pivot. And those franchises that do well have done well because they have pivoted, right? Look at Late Night with John Oliver, or Last Week with John Oliver. That's a show that does a lot of research. And so they, wrapped in comedy, they have turned it into a trusted source. And that value is not the information, but the trust, the effort. The same is true for education. Something I talked about with, you know, other educators, with my family, with my kids. Education is not about imparting information anymore. You can get information off here. Education is not the gatekeeper of information. What it could be is the arbiter of quality, the certifier of quality knowledge and thinking processes in someone's head, saying, hey, we know there's a lot of information. We have taught this person how to critically think. We have taught this person how to deal with volumes of information of varying degrees of truthfulness. We have taught this person how to navigate and prioritize the swamp of information that you're surrounded by. There's value in that. But a lot of education entities from grade school and high school to college and higher education have not figured that out yet. They still think they are in the information imparting business, and they're not. In your industry, what is scarce? And how do you provide what is scarce? Is trust scarce in your industry? Do people just not trust companies in your industry? Is human connection? Do you have a community that you're part of? If there isn't a community in your industry, in your vertical, make one, because that human connection is super valuable. Is correct information scarce? Is time scarce? Is money scarce? There's no shortage of scarcity for things that people value right now. And generative AI, and all AI, will have quite a bit of difficulty filling those scarce needs right now, right? Generative AI can't do the human connection part. It can't today really do well with correct information. It can't do well with trust. These are things that we do. It may adapt and grow into some of those roles more in the future, but today, generative AI cannot provide those scarce resources. So that is part of your marketing strategy, your business strategy. What is scarce? What is abundant? And are you just doing more of what's already abundant? And if so, you're just going to get lost. No one will find you because there's just a sea of similar stuff. If you build something that's scarce, people will find it like, hey, that stands out. That's different. Let's check that out. I will make this concrete marketing recommendation as the takeaway from today. The single most important marketing strategy you can embrace right now is the building of a strong, trustworthy, human-led brand. A strong, trustworthy, human-led brand. As machines create ever more information and we have less and less time and cognitive bandwidth to process that information, you have the opportunity to be a filter, a screen against the noise, a shelter, a trusted advisor in the truest meaning of that phrase, not the, you know, the trite consulting talk, but a truly trusted advisor to your audience, to your community, and your customers. That is your opportunity right now to build a brand around that. The comedian Zay Frank used to end his video shows with his trademark phrase, thinking so you don't have to. While tongue-in-cheek a couple of decades ago, wow, that was 2 decades ago now. Wow. While tongue-in-cheek a couple of decades ago, that is now a real powerful brand promise that you could offer your audience. Think so that they don't have to. Do the hard work for them, and they will give you value in exchange. All right, let's talk about what else happened this week. Besides the generative AI course that I'm relentlessly flogging, I did a fun, entertaining fireside chat with James Beard-winning author Geraldine DeRuyter. Is that fireside chat? You can watch that video. I had a lot of fun talking about her new book, Food, Fury, and Feminism. So go check that out. Also talked about retrieval augmented generation for tax law and also some stuff on software and backups and things. Some thinking things for you to do on that front. Do go take the Generative AI for Marketers workshop. We're going to be updating that this month. I have a whole new section I need to update about what's new. So that, of course, is staying fresh and relevant. Let's take a look at jobs that are open right now. We have digital customer analytics analyst at Genuine Parts Company, digital product analytics analyst at Genuine Parts Company, analytics specialist at Leap, I guess, conversion analyst at Peak Ace, digital marketing data engineer at Web Mechanics, director of content marketing at Outreach, director of marketing and partner operations at Writer, director of data operations at Marriott International, full stack developer at SVT Play, Hard Rock Digital Manager at Hard Rock Digital, okay, manager of analytics at Genuine Parts Company, manager of digital merchandising at Marriott, measurement strategist at the DC Metro, senior data analyst at Point, senior digital analyst at Peak Ace, SEO specialist at Leap, and senior analyst at digital and e-commerce at Genuine Parts Company. So lots and lots of marketing jobs appearing out there. What else happened in the news this week? Of course, the EU AI Act that was ratified. YouTube now has 100 million premium subscribers, which is a pretty astonishing number, which I'm very surprised at. Universal Music Group pulled its music from TikTok, causing chaos across the platform. They revoked their licensing, which, of course, is their right to do. We had the testimonies on Capitol Hill about generative AI and all things AI. Mark Zuckerberg actually had a lot to say about open source and open weights data in his testimonial. And even though he always comes across as like an alien that just arrived on Earth, his points were very good about the importance of open source and open weights models, that they are a bulwark against individual big tech companies controlling AI by giving everyone the opportunity to use AI with models that they run and modify locally, which I do agree with. We also have, let's see, digital bank currencies. Oh, Canada and the UK have signed an AI agreement to share computing power. So lots of stuff happening on that front. Upcoming events. I'll be at the Tourism Industry Association of Alberta's Tourism Summit this week, followed by the Independent Collegiate Booksellers Association, then Social Media Marketing World, the Society for Marketing Professional Services, the Australian Food and Grocery Council, and MayCon. And there's a couple other events coming up soon. So lots and lots of time on the road. If you're at any of these events, do come up and say hi. You'll easily recognize me. I'm wearing a very large mask most of the time because COVID still a thing. That's going to do it for this week's newsletter. Thank you for being here, for watching or listening or reading. I appreciate it, and I'll talk to you next time. If you enjoyed this video, please hit the like button. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, And if you want to know when new videos are available, hit the bell button to be notified as soon as new content is live.